PhD. Fabrizio is an adjunct professor in the School of Foreign Languages and Literature, Translation and Interpreting in Bologna. He's one of those very unusual and highly to be prized people who is both a practitioner, an interpreter and translator, and also an academic, which is, I think, excellent. He's a master's degree in competent interpreting from the University of Trieste, and he spent several years in the UK. He got the diploma in public service interpreting, the famous DIPSI, which is a very highly prized certificate, and completed his PhD in police interpreting at the University of Salford. So I think he's somebody with enormous, both academic and practitioner qualifications. So we look forward to hearing your paper.
Thank you, Hilary, for the very kind words. Perhaps too kind. No. So shall we dim the lights a little bit? Can you see the slides? Yeah, you can. All right, fine. So again, thank you for the introduction. Yeah. And, thank you. First thing, I need to apologise because my voice is a bit the way it is. In Florence at the moment, it's minus whatever, I don't know, it's so cold, I can't tell you. I know it doesn't, you know, it doesn't sound real, but it is much colder than it is here. So I'm a bit under the weather at the moment, but never mind. I hope you can understand what I'm saying. If you have any issue with my horrible voice today, or my accent, or whatever, just, you know, raise your hand, and I'll be pleased to repeat and repeat again. So, yes, my name is Fabrizio Gallai, and I'll be talking to you today about police interpreting, in particular, how to go beyond the existing codes of ethics that there are out there. Now, first thing, that's me now, as Hilary's just introduced me as a young professor, a very old man, and there was, however, me in a much younger form 5 years ago when I was still good looking and young and my skin wasn't breaking all the time, and as an NRPSI legal interpreter for this country. Do you all know what NRPSI stands for? NRPSI is the National Register for Public Service Interpreters, which is based in London, and it's been serving this country for about 16 years now. And it's a register that holds a list of all qualified and certified interpreters, public service interpreters. So when I say public service interpreting, what do you think I mean? What settings do you think we can find a public service interpreter in?
Hospitals. Social services.
Very good. What else? It's a long list, but give us some more. Social services, hospitals,
police.
Courts.
Army.
Courts, very good.
Army.
The army. Yes, the military, let's say. If it's government-run, if it's a government-run thing, then you could talk about public services. If it's an international organisation thing, it's slightly different, but I won't go into that. What about solicitors' offices? Think about anything to do with education, right? Teachers having to talk to their kids, mothers and fathers who don't speak the language of the country. They're still public service. So it's a huge, huge context. And as I said, I was working in the legal setting, yeah? So legal setting meaning police, courts, all sorts of things, solicitors, yeah, anything to do with the legal system. So the first thing I want to show you is a video. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I'm going to show you a little short video of a police interview mediated by an interpreter. It's in Chinese. Does anybody of you here speak Chinese? Yes, I wish I could as well. Now, it's a video that's been made by Harry Port University in Edinburgh. It's really interesting. And I'm going to show you just a small clip. It's a Chinese interpreter who's interpreting for a suspect, and they're talking about an object which is being presented to her, to the suspect, who's Chinese. And she's describing the object and the man who was dealing the object, okay? So let me get to the point. It was minute 12. Okay, she's talking Chinese. She's
a
Can you hear? I can't do anything about it.
I think you have to do it like that.
Sorry?
You have to do it
on the box if you like
to know.
That's just what you want. Oh, thank you.
That one?
That one,
that one. So
we'll
try that.
Now we'll get to the English bit, don't worry.
25岁的样子.
Well, this person is a Chinese. He spoke with a Fujian accent. Fujian is a province on the southeast coast of China, just opposite Taiwan. So I couldn't understand him very well in the beginning. He's rather tall, about 25 years old.
Okay. Can you tell me anything about this clip? Anything that comes up to your head? Anything? Did you see anything weird, odd, anything that you didn't expect to happen? This is a very normal interviewing room. The setting is very normal. You have two police officers. One of them will be the sergeant. And obviously, as you've seen before, you've got a suspect or the victim with the interpreter sitting next to them. But apart from the setting, you heard what the interpreter said. Is there anything at all that, you know, struck you in any way?
She's adding extra information. I mean, I'm guessing she was Chinese.
What extra information was she adding?
The province, the accent.
Yeah.
The man and the province.
So you understood straight away that that was an addition.
Yeah.
Good. Did you know where the province was? Good. Now, just to brainstorm a little bit, let's have a look at another video here. This one was made by Cambridgeshire Constabulary a couple of years back, and they made a series of videos to help police officers work with interpreters, yeah? This one is with Polish. Does anybody here speak Polish?
When trying to gain information via an interpreter, it is important to direct all your conversation to the client and not to the interpreter. Your conversation is with the client, not with the interpreter.
Can you ask Camille if he was the driver of the vehicle at the time of the accident and tell me about the other vehicle, what the weather was like and what the visibility was like, please?
Jaka była widoczność na drodze, jaka była pogoda i czy to ty prowadziłeś?
Tak, ja prowadziłem. Dlaczego mnie to wypytuje? To nie było z mojej winy.
Yes, I was driving. Why is he asking me all this?
To nie było z mojej winy.
It wasn't my fault.
Co on zapisuje i dlaczego?
What is he writing and why?
You asked me what the other vehicle was like.
Czy możesz spytać Kamila, jak wyglądał ten drugi samochód?
Był czerwony i trochę zardzewiały. Nadal nie rozumiem, dlaczego jestem przesłuchiwany.
It was red and a bit rusty. I still don't understand why I'm being questioned.
Sorry, did you say red and muddy?
Przepraszam, czy powiedział czerwony i trochę zabłocony?
Czerwony i zardzewiały. Skąd on wziął zabłocony?
It's red and rusty. Where did he get muddy from?
Okay, źle się czuję. Nie mogę tego teraz kontynuować. Może zawołać mojego lekarza.
He's not very happy. He's not in a good state and not very happy. Why do you think he's not very happy? Why do you think he wants a doctor and he doesn't want to talk to the police officer anymore?
Because he feels sort of attacked in a way.
Attacked?
Yeah, like he feels like it's his fault when it's actually not him. And the interpreter doesn't make it better.
And why do you think that's the case?
Because she needs to emphasize with them. It's a different scenario. Like, she's an interpreter for this case, so she needs to adapt to the environment and like, yeah. Make the patient understand that, you know, everything's going to be fine in a bit. It's like, for each job that you do, it's not just interpreting, but it's like the other aspects of the environment that you need to consider.
So you think the interpreter was meant to be reassuring him? Or is
not
that
reassuring
what you're
in a way,
to...
but maybe questioning it differently.
a different manner, a different approach.
You're saying it's interpreter's fault that he got a bit mad?
Yeah.
Okay.
Things as the case of implicit fields talked about by the other two. It's not direct, as you said before, it's not directed towards him, it's directed towards the lady who understands the same language. And she's not the link, but she's rather the person who is in charge of the answers. And that person might feel that, as he doesn't know what she's saying to the policeman, that might trigger him asking those questions.
Good. Nice brainstorming. Well done. Now, this will all come to help us in a couple of minutes. So, just bear all your comments in mind, please, from current slide. So, now, what am I going to talk about? Hopefully, I'll start with a very brief overview of legislation, of legal interpreter and translations right. Then, I'm going to be trying to define legal interpreter and translation. Talking about language of the law, then what an investigative interview is. Why is it not going forward? Then my research on discourse markers, and finally some conclusions. I'm not sure I'll be able to touch upon all those points, but we'll try, yeah? And if you have any questions at any point, please raise your hand, yeah? Feel free to interrupt, throw me stones, throw me books in my face. I won't worry too much. So, why do we exist as legal interpreters? We exist, first thing, because it's an ever-growing movement of citizens throughout the world. I'm sure you've noticed this in the UK. The UK is one of the countries with the highest number of immigrants in the world. But where do these migrants end up? They end up in a lot of places, but also in police stations, social welfare centres, hospitals and courts, where the interpreter provides service for laymen and officials when they speak different languages. I think that is the nicest, neatest definition of a legal interpreter or an interpreter, public service interpreter that you can find, yeah? It's the most neutral definition, yeah? So there's a need for interacting with public government, public offices, and there, if you don't speak the language of the country that's hosting you, you need an interpreter, right? Now, that's all good. So, the country that hosts these people should, before the law, provide for an interpreter or translator, and an interpreter or translator which accurately conveys what is being said and written. So not just a person you can get out of the street, yeah? It has to be someone who's able to do the job, isn't it? Just like in every other sector. Do you agree with me? People need to be accurate. Well, what does international legislation say about this? Well, Article 7 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is where everything comes from for us. And it's a beautiful, beautifully written piece of writing. It says, all are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection of the law. Isn't it beautiful? Now, it is beautiful, but have countries in the world, and in particular in the EU, helped contribute to the promotion and common standards of this profession? Big question. You're shaking your head, unfortunately. Yeah. You might be right in your thinking. Well, let's say that different countries have different approaches. I can't focus on the whole world. In some areas of the world, we don't even have data, so I wouldn't be able to talk about them. But let's focus on the EU. Well, let's say that there's people who've been studying the provision of services, and they've been telling us, especially somebody called Hertog, they've been telling us that there's a lot of different approaches to the matter. Obviously, ranging from the most helpful to the least helpful systems, right? Diversity of practices. We can say that the countries which are heir to the common law, so I'm thinking about the US, the UK, Australia in particular, Canada, have very good, usually very good, public service interpreting systems. The rest, including my country, which is heir to the civic law, they don't have it. So, what does it mean to have a good, trustworthy LIT, legal interpreting and translation system? Well, according to the European Convention on Human Rights, it means that you've got to have a system where everyone who's arrested can be informed promptly in a language which he understands of the reasons of his arrest. So promptly is key here, I think. It needs to be quick and efficient, isn't it? You have to provide someone there and then. There's other pieces of legislation. You've got a lot of articles from EU statutes, such as the Rome Statute. You've got articles from treaties, EU treaties, like the Treaty of Amsterdam. But essentially, they say that it is absolutely key to have a reliable communication, for the quality of all decisions and actions depends upon the quality of information and communication on which they're based. So I think you need to remember the words reliable and quality. Not just communication, we need to have a reliable kind of communication. Now, a big watershed in my world in legal interpreting has been the directive in 2010, which includes the need for appropriately qualified and professional legal interpreters. And it also asks for EU countries to provide, to set up a national register of public service interpreters. A register or registers, okay? Obviously, what do you think? Us researchers, if we look at this piece of legislation, what are we going to ask ourselves? The need for appropriately qualified professional legal interpreters who can perform quality work.
Who defines the professional?
Yeah, certificate. I mean, yeah, diploma.
How do you define quality, after all? Yeah? Because that's what's not there, isn't it? Yeah? You're asking us to provide a quality system, high quality system. What does quality mean, right? It's not said that, but it's quite an important piece of information to be able to come up with an effective, efficient system, right? Well, we had, and I'm using the past tense here appropriately, we used to have, even better, a successful example in the European Union called National Register of Public Service Interpreters, of which I used to be a representative. I've shown you the card, you believe me. Now, the National Register of Public Service Interpreters is still there, you can check it online, but it's kind of no longer functional, let's put it that way. It's slightly more complicated than that, but let's say, unfortunately, it doesn't serve its purpose anymore because the service has been outsourced to a private company. And not just any private company, it has been outsourced to a company called Capita. If I say Capita, does it ring the bell?
Yes.
It should. If it doesn't, just check it out online, because you'll find interesting things about this Capita company. It's a massive, massive, huge company, yeah. Which runs a lot of different smaller companies, including the one that runs.
Why is it bad? Why is it bad?
Why is it very bad, you said? Yes. Because, as a matter of fact, after the outsourcing to this private company, the system crashed. There has been a lot of reports of very bad service being provided to courts and police stations throughout the country. Interpreters that haven't been vetted or who are not qualified for the job, who are not competent, who have no qualification to speak of, who've been sent out to courtrooms and police stations in this country day in and day out, not doing their job, that they were being very poorly paid for anyway. So you just, you know, go on to Google and Google something like scandal public courtroom interpreting UK, you'll find a list of articles, even from tabloids like the Daily Mail, which are usually quite pro these kinds of companies. And you'll find that, you know, even then, they're starting to question this outsourcing, because the system has really crashed. There's magistrates complaining, there's judges complaining, and there's trials that are being obviously closed down redone because the interpreters didn't show up. They showed up and they spoke a different language. There's all sorts of things that I could talk about now, but definitely something worth checking about if you're interested in this, yeah? Anyhow, this is just to say that the system at the moment is a bit in bad conditions, yeah, in this country, which used to be a beacon of hope for other EU countries, yeah? Obviously, you know, there was some serious issues concerning the old system as well. I'm not saying it was perfect, yeah? There wasn't a monitoring mechanism to speak of. A number of languages that were needed weren't there. Some African dialects and other languages. They didn't have enough qualified interpreters for those languages. Well, I'll be talking about that later. Let's look it out. There has been opposition to the new system over the years. Opposition started in 2012 and is still ongoing. And it's by a number of associations which deal with public services in general. It's by single interpreters, it's by international associations. And as I said, there are many scandals covered by the media now, which, you know, are in very high numbers at the moment. But the contract has been renewed, so the Capitaine will be working as the main provider for again a number of years. So that we don't know what's going to be like for this country's legal interpreting in the future, but you know, keep an eye out if you're interested. I'll definitely will. Okay. We've talked about provision of services. We still haven't defined what the legal interpreter and translator is. Who are these beasts, these animals that crawl around and go to courtrooms and police stations? Well, I've tried to give a neutral definition before. Let's be slightly more specific now. Well, Hertog, who is the same guy I was talking about before, said that a legal interpreter and translator, a LIT, is a trained, qualified professional who provides interpreting and translation services to those involved in whatever capacity in a legal system in whose language they're not fully competent. Again, the element of quality is creeping up. Can you see it? And again, we don't have a footnote to explain us what quality means. A small piece of information which is interesting though is that in the world of research, they've split up the area covering courtroom with the area covering immigration, asylum and police. Why do you think that's the case? Why do you think researchers have found them in themselves to split up the world of legal interpreting research into two? in particular those two categories.
Because like asylum seekers and stuff, police and immigration, they have like, they are vulnerable in a way, and they need maybe a different way of, like a different setting, because they've been...
That's very true. First thing, the setting is different. You've got a more of an interviewing room setting. Very true. The other reason, and it's slightly more subtle, is that the courtroom is seen as the apex of the legal system. And that's always been the case in legal studies. And we've borrowed that image of the legal system, of the courtroom as the apex, yeah, as the maximum you can reach in legal terms. Which is not true, however. There have been many, many studies now which demonstrate very clearly that police work is the most important work in terms of evidence collection and really defining where the case is going to go. Yeah? So the research goes counter to that, but the legal services, legal people, legal studies still see the courtroom as kind of, yeah, the zenith. I've said that. Yes, the courtroom is the apex, but courtroom interpreting and immigration, asylum and police interpreting share two things. The first thing, we're both Cinderellas within the world of interpreting studies. Do you know which other setting gets the most attention?
Yeah.
If it's not, yes, conference interpreting. You familiar with conference interpreting? When I say conference interpreting, what do I mean?
Business conference.
No.
Simultaneous.
You know people sitting in a soundproof cubicle interpreting simultaneously what's being said into the microphone? Does it ring a bell?
Yeah.
Have you seen those beasts being locked up in the cubicles, though? Well, believe it or not, even though it's less common nowadays, conference interpreting still gets the most attention by researchers and academics alike. Yeah, and so we're both Cinderellas. Public service interpreting is a Cinderella compared to conference interpreting. And the other thing we share is that we're part of a tightly knit, dominant profession. Have you ever been to a courtroom, or a police station for that matter? Have you? Okay, raise your hand if you've been to a courtroom. Half of you. Police stations. It's lovely. I definitely invite you to go. Well, have you seen how everything is rehearsed?
Yeah.
It feels like you're in a theatre. No? Have you seen, those of you who've been, can you confirm this? Yeah, you've got the judge sitting physically above you, yeah, and they looking down on you, and at first it's not a nice feeling. I remember when I was working as a courtroom interpreter, I walk in, and obviously you know that each morning, first thing they do is they salute the Queen, which makes much sense to me, so I'm not even a subject. Anyway, I'd have to say, I can't remember what I had to say, something to the Queen. And that was, you know, part of the theatre, wasn't it? It's part of the performance. But this performance has a legal consequence, so it's not just to play. But still, you are in a hierarchy, aren't you? So who's the head of the hierarchy? What do you think?
Who's judge.
The judge. He's the head of your... If you walk into courtroom, he's gonna, you know, he can tell you go out, go in. He can do everything. And in a police station, who's the head? Who's the boss? Who's the judge?
Police inspector.
Yeah, depends who's there, but usually sergeants. Yeah. Chief sergeants and top ranging police officers. Good. So we're all struggling with that definition. Yeah, with the definition that an interpreter who walks into a courtroom is less important than a lawyer, a solicitor, a magistrate, a judge. Can you see that the interpreter is on par with the cleaning lady who comes in at 7 o'clock in the evening to clean the room? There's nothing wrong with being a cleaning lady. The problem is your responsibility might be a little bit higher than the cleaning lady, but you're still on par with the cleaning lady. Yeah, unfortunately. Now, in all this chaos, there's codes of conduct that you need to follow very strictly because they're legally binding, so you can't just ignore them. Yeah, there's codes of conduct, beautiful codes, beautifully written codes of conduct, just like the article from the UN Declaration of Human Rights, which they all say that. That interpreters, practitioners, shall interpret truly and faithfully what is uttered without adding, omitting, or changing anything. They all say this, believe me. I've read about 1,000 codes of conduct. Unlucky me. But they all say that interpreters cannot add, cannot omit, cannot change. Now, does any of you here have any experience with translation and interpreting? You said so before. Anybody else? You. So, which languages have you been working with? Okay, and English. Into English. So, very different languages coming from very different families. Does this look like something that makes any sense in linguistic terms to you?
It's difficult because I think when we think about interpreting or translation, the medium is language, and it's not as neat and coherent as the definition looks. So there's always a struggle, you know, words. Do you do them verbatim? Yes, you need to, because if you're sharing information. But then there's also all sorts of emotions to deal with, you know. So it's always information, but, you know, you do add something new. There's a sense, for example, if you're in a hospital, sometimes they're like, am I going to live or die? So you know, you turn back to the doctor and say that. And
okay, that's kind of the extra verbal bit.
Yes.
But tell me, you speak Hindi, you said?
Hindi,
yeah. How do you say, in Hindi, this chair will be thrown out soon? Okay. Can you translate it literally back into English? Verbatim. Yeah, literally.
Yes, this chair. Ye chair, kursi. So again, you know, it depends if
No, literally. Just tell me element by element.
This chair, ye kursi, will be thrown out soon. Jaldi hi.
But are you saying thrown? Are you saying out?
So it's like ye kursi, this chair soon will be thrown out.
Thank you. That's called syntax. That's called word order. There is no such thing as a match between syntactical structures between any given language in the world. Only some Latin-based languages, some Germanic languages together, they can have some word order structures which resemble each other. But very, very rarely, and anyhow, it's not just, language is not just about syntax, word order. There's so many levels to language. So this formulation doesn't make any linguistic sense whatsoever. Does, for any of you who speak foreign language, does this make sense, what I'm saying? No?
Yeah, what you're saying, yeah.
Good. Yeah, and that is law, though. That's what I'm saying. That is law. That is what police interpreters, court representatives have to abide by if they want to work in this or any other country in the world. So I was working as a police officer, as a police interpreter, sorry, as a practitioner, and I was asking myself this all the time. I'm going against this code of conduct. Am I going to hell? do I need to throw myself out of the window? Will I be in prison myself one of these days? I was sick and tired, and I decided to become a practice searcher. That is a mix, a half breed of researcher and practitioner. Okay, so I was sick and tired of what in research is called literalism. Yeah, verbatim translation, going word for word. It just, I was asking myself, all those verbatim renditions that they claim to be possible, are they even possible, ever possible? And I thought that this was adding stress to my profession. There's a lot of what they're called work environment related stress factors, such as where your chair is, your position is, you're not given water, you're not given turn up talk, stuff like that. But there's also this kind of stress, yeah? Legal pressure on you. Do you see what I mean? Legally binding things that you always feel on you if you work as a police interpreter or courtroom interpreter. I was sick and tired. I said, I'd better become a researcher. Okay? Good. And I was also sick and tired because, what's this doing here? I was hearing this stuff all the time. This is from my corpus, my data. The police officer is saying, just that this interview was with a mother who's accused of killing her 3-month-old child. Her 3-month-old child just died, and she was called in to be interviewed. And she was obviously, evidently shocked. The police officer was looking at her. He was looking at the mother, and she wasn't responding that much. She was just muttering some words. And then all of a sudden, the police officer said, okay, good. I just want to make, it's difficult, sorry, with translating these bits, Letitia, the mother, because it sounds a bit more complicated than what it is, he says, the police officer to the mother. As if the translation is adding to the stressful situation, which is, you know, it's meant to be stressful if you're being accused of killing your own daughter. It's never a good situation to be in, yeah. And still, the police officer is accusing the interpreter, calling him a translator, by the way, which is something I hate. double whammy. Police officers accusing interpreters all the time. Not good. We've talked about debunking the myth of word-for-word translation. Now, we don't just have a legal problem, we also have a language problem. The language of the law is a very, very specific kind of language. And it's been shown by a lot of researchers that the legal system, is obviously an important and influential institution, but it's an institution that's packed with language problems. Can you tell me which linguistic problems you can envisage within the legal system?
Very complex.
If you've been to a courtroom, sorry.
Very complex sentences, lots of clauses.
Yeah, word order we talked about. It's not the chair that's been thrown, it's the chair that's allegedly, supposedly being thrown away from. Yeah, good.
So, a lot of clauses means a lot of connectives, which means that you feel sort of like exactly what the connective is saying, you know.
Ooh, can you marry, would you marry me? Because I
should have been.
But I'll talk about connectives there.
Because a colleague of mine, Jacqueline Visconti in Italy, she's done a lot of research about it, you know, in legal translation on connectives. So
yes.
I know it.
Do you know what connective is? Connectives are little words such as...
They should know.
They should know.
Yeah, they should.
They're looking at me with blank faces. I don't want to say, are you their lecturer?
Yeah.
You very well know what a connective is, don't you? It's those little words such as well, you know, so, which some linguists say that connect bits and pieces of text. Yeah, I don't believe in that theory, but I'm just repeating what they say. Yeah. So I say this chair needs to be thrown out, so let's throw it out. Yes. Yeah. So people say we'll connect the first to the second sentence by creating a consequence, right? Needs to be thrown out. Therefore, as a consequence, I decide that we need to throw this out. Yeah. And I'll be talking about, I could talk about that for 3 years, but I will be touching upon that soon. I should be finishing, shouldn't I? I'll just try and wrap it up. And so, packed with linguistic problems. Just to show you one slide, what are these problems? They're linked with the genre. Language is, legal language is a genre. They're linked to the its writtenness, what you said. The structures are linked to written text, written kind of language. It's very technical, so lexis now, words, yeah. So, and you don't talk about wedding, you talk about marriage in certain cases, and they're not the same thing.
And also more said with a single specific meaning, you can have any ambiguity. Yeah,
they usually have a one-to-one equivalent, yeah. You can't mess about with legal terms because they have to be, they're linked to codes a lot of the times, yeah, they're linked to pieces of legislation. And what interests me most today is the power disparities and hyperformality of the setting. Yeah. I was talking about the hierarchy before. This is what it refers to. You're part of a hierarchy, which always means a power disparity. Does it make sense to you? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good. I can skip the next 55 slides, and I will if I know how to do this. Very briefly, in all this, there is police interviews and police interpreting, which is a sub-genre of legal interpreting and law legals. Yeah. Now, police interviews, I said it before, has a very important role to play within the criminal justice system. And that's because it provides the courts with the documentary evidence or soft facts in the form of written statements, electronic recordings of interviews, and corresponding transcripts. So its aim is to obtain complete, accurate, relevant, and reliable information fairly, so as to ensure that this will be admissible in the later stages of the process. Okay? So it's a very, very important step within the legal system. Some people say the most important step. And it's been the enhanced cognitive interview method has been all the rage and now for quite some time. Mm. It's a very specific way of conducting interviews that was born in the US and then developed here as well in the UK. And now it's used by every single police officer in this country. And so when I was studying this and when police interpreting scholars study this, always try and see what impact interpreters have on the language, but also on the interviewing techniques. Can you see this? Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, interpreting within a police setting is not just a cognitive exercise. It has a purpose, right? And if our work impacts on their techniques, on this enhanced cognitive method, then we know we're doing our job incorrectly, right? Now, I can't go too much into detail, but believe me, there's been a lot of scholars over the past 10 years or so who've shown that interpreters have a massive impact on police interviewing techniques. Whenever there's an interpreter around, things go wrong. Police officers don't like it because they see that we're doing a mess, we're making a mess. So, you know, media scandals are linked to bad provision of services, But sometimes they're right in saying that there's not enough qualified and quality interpreters around. There's a lot of interpreters who don't know about these techniques. What I'm proposing is that as part of our training as interpreters, legal interpreters, we should know more about the system which works behind the wings. Yeah? Another thing that we found, me and other scholars, again over the past 10 years, because this particular field of study is very, very recent. It's all very new and exciting for us because there's not many scholars working on this. Can you also guess why there's not many people working on this field?
Difficult to get information, I guess.
Yeah.
Very difficult to get corpus. I got a corpus from Greater Manchester Police Authorities and I was deemed very, very lucky by a lot of colleagues of mine, yeah? And I was indeed very lucky, yeah? In Italy, they just can't provide it. Yeah? It's illegal. So if you want to get it, you have to be in the UK or elsewhere, but not many countries do share that information, yeah? Anyhow, what we found, and this is the last thing I'm going to say today, sorry, is that interpreters do mess about and they also have different roles than the one, the verbatim interpreter we talked about before. In particular, we have these six roles. We sometimes assume the position of co-interlocutor, asking questions, or adding bits of information. Do you remember the Chinese interpreter at the beginning? She added the bit about the province, Fujian province. Do you think she was right or do you think she was wrong in adding that piece of information?
We could have done that.
That's
well,
right.
Sorry,
it was,
the
yeah. That's right. So it was essential to the understanding of the interaction, yeah. So when I'm saying the interpreter has the role of co-interlocutor, it doesn't always mean it's wrong. Sometimes that is right, but not always, yeah? Then sometimes she has to adjust or adapt discourses in order to give them more voice. She can control the attribution of talks at all, in terms of a talk, to their advantage or to that of another party. Again, sometimes the turn managing is done correctly, sometimes it's done incorrectly, yeah? Then she can reframe a question and that's going to steer an interviewee towards the preferred answer. And that is sometimes the role of discourse connectives, the ones that you have no idea about, but they are used very specifically by legal interpreters, and this has been shown by me, but by other scholars as well, a lot of scholars, that they are very useful at steering people's thought processes, let's put it that way, yeah? So, if I use a so, I can imply that there's a consequence there. Perhaps in the original text, there was no such implication. Do you know what I mean? I add the so, it wasn't there, I'm adding the idea of consequence. You think it's just a little thing, but believe me, in certain cases, it's not. I sound like some American actor. Number five, by their own active participation, they deflect attention from what's being said by primary participant. Sometimes that's good, for instance, you need to interrupt because there's a misunderstanding. People just keep... Remember the Polish video where he got muddy wrong and the interpreter didn't stop the flow. Do you think she was right in not stopping, in not interrupting? No, she was wrong, because she was seeing the misunderstanding as she didn't stop it. And that's led to him, the victim, saying, I don't want to talk to you anymore. So that had a consequence. The mismanagement of the interaction had a consequence, a legal consequence. Last one, through body posture, gaze and kinetics. It's a lot of studies now, very interesting. They exhibit an attitude that may tacitly cast doubt on or lend authority to what being said. For instance, you do this. You're showing disapproval, aren't you? And perhaps there was no such thing as disapproval from the original speaker, right? And you're adding that to the... It's just a gaze, but it has consequences. Bear in mind that these interviewing techniques that I talked about are all about the extraverbal, the way that police officers are meant to move, look at you all the time, to extract information, yeah? There's a lot of books about gestures and using your hands. Nothing is by chance. If you read those manuals for police officers, you'll notice that everything is done for a purpose. It's quite scary, but you get into the head, because those are psychological techniques to get to extract information. So, just to draw some consequences, skipping everything about the sports market, just want to say that my research shows an extremely high number of shifts, whatever done now, God knows, it's better if I keep it that way, oh no, an extremely high number of shifts, both at micro and macro level, resulting in, and from the interpreter's initial mission, an addition of discourse markers in all phases of the interview. And that means that utterances by primary participants are subject to distortion, omission, and amplification. First thing I want to suggest is that we need to transcribe those bloody interviews, because if you don't transcribe the interpretation as well, you'll never know that the interpreting was wrong, for instance. Yeah. This is my first suggestion. Second suggestion, we need to enhance training and certification. So put in some pragmatic and interviewing techniques bits into the training of police officers and interpreters. And I suggest that interpreters have to intervene, yes, whenever it's legitimate, but they have to be very careful in their intervention. We need to change how we perceive interpreters' normative role. So, at the end of the day, we need to have a more nuanced kind of code of conduct, code of ethics. Yeah. That was everything. I tried to squeeze in a lot of information there. I wasn't very successful. I hope you managed to follow what I was talking about. Yeah. So, I just want to thank you, and I hope you've enjoyed my talk.